Okay, so let us start mechanical properties of solids. A few please write down. Arushi, what is going on in your school?
In my school, actually they're doing kinetic property of gases or whatever,
kinetic theory of
matter.
Only kinetic theory.
Yeah, right now they're doing that.
Yeah, even for us, they're doing the same thing.
All the laws and all of that.
Okay, that is what I'm doing in NPS as well. But then chapter was remaining, so if we don't do it, it'll keep on getting delayed. So let us complete this up. Okay. So after this, we'll probably start kinetic theory. Fine?
Yeah.
Okay, so this particular chapter focuses on mechanical properties of solid. So we have already done two chapters related to properties of matter. Can you tell me what are those?
We're doing related to fluid, right?
So we have done mechanical properties of fluids.
Yeah.
One chapter. Any other chapter related to properties we have done?
We have done surface tension and all of that, but
we did thermal properties of matter.
Yeah.
We have done mechanical properties of liquid and thermal properties of all the matters, whether it is gas, liquid or solid. Okay. Now, thermal properties are very similar when it comes to a liquid or gas or any solid. But when it comes to mechanical properties are different between solid and liquid or gas. Okay. And also the kind of mechanical properties that you are interested in solid, you are not interested in similar kind of properties of a liquid. For example, in liquid, I am more interested in pressure and the velocity of the flow. Okay. That is a kind of mechanical property I am focusing on. But when it comes to solid, solid doesn't flow and solid will not move, immediately because of the pressure difference. It will not start flowing. So those properties are useless to study for the solid. Now, we are focusing on strength of solid when it comes to mechanical properties of solid. Why we are focusing on strength of solid? Because solid is the material that we are using to build the machines, to build the bikes, cars, planes, buildings. Everything is made up of solids, right? And when it comes to building any such structure, we need to focus on the strength of that material. Fine. So same kind of property will not study for gas or liquid, because I don't care about strength of liquid. It doesn't mean anything actually. All right. So that is the reason why two different chapters. In this chapter, we are focusing on strength of solid. Okay. And if you take civil engineering, then you're going to study the same chapter for next 2-3 years. There are a lot of small details that are there. For example, if I have to make a metro station, then I need to first of all study how is the soil there. If the soil is loose and it is not able to hold the structure, it's not strong, I'll not be able to build pillars on top of that soil. Okay. Yeah. And similarly, I'll not be able to build a multi-story building. But if soil holds good, then I can think of building a big structure on top of it. Otherwise, the soil only will not support, then everything will fall apart. So that is the reason why, suppose few years back on some, surface, there was lake. So now lake is disappeared, but that lake is encroached and now people are building structures on that space where lake was there. But it is not a good idea because the soil there may not support, very strongly. All right. So, and then you need to also understand how the solids will behave when it expands. Will it crack, or how much it will crack, how much load it can take, and different kinds of loads are also there. Okay, for example, if I take a brick and if I try to apply a lot of force, I mean, if I put a lot of force from above, the brick, suppose this is a brick, and if I push from this side and that side, it will take a lot of load. But if I same brick, if I fix this point and if I push from this side, then this brick will break.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There are a lot of finer details when it comes to mechanical properties of solids. And also you might be seeing in earlier days, people used to have beams on the terrace also. So they will have beam inside the room, which is placed on the roof. So this beam will definitely bend like this. So how much it will bend, what will happen if it bends, whether it will crack or not. If it cracks, then will it completely fail? So all those kind of properties are of great importance whenever we build any structure. Okay. So that is why this chapter is there, just to introduce to you that such things exist, and things are not in great detail. That is why a very small chapter is there in front of you. Okay. Now, coming back to the strength of solid, as we have mentioned that the strength of solid will be different with respect to how you are trying to apply the force or whatever makes it break. So we need to categorize different kind of forces that can be applied, okay, how it is applied and things like that. Fine. Now, before we start this chapter, let us take one example. Suppose there is a pencil heel. You know, right? What is pencil heel?
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is a pencil heel and this is elephant's leg. Okay, so both of them are standing. This lady is standing on a wooden plank on just pencil heels, and the elephant is also standing on a similar wooden plank, okay, on one leg. The elephant's mass is around 6,000 kg. Okay, the mass of this lady could be just 60 kg. Where do you think the more chances that the solid will have a dent on it, permanent dent?
Well, with the heels, right?
Heels.
Because it's concentrated at one.
Yeah, pressure. There's more pressure.
So yeah. It is not about force that breaks the solid. Okay. Yeah. Force doesn't cause a material to break.
Yeah.
It is a force per unit area that breaks a solid. All right. So force per unit area is more important than force itself. You may be applying huge amount of force, but if that force is spread across a greater area, force per unit area will be lesser.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Then that will not break a material. What I'm trying to say is that there is a fixed value of force per unit area for every solid to break. So it is like force per unit area, if it is 100, then this solid will break. So if I take just one unit of area and if I have 100 unit of force, then force per unit area is 100. Okay. Yeah. But if I take 1000 Newton of force and 1000 unit of area also, then force per unit area is one only.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even if force is more, the material will not break. The material breaks because of force per unit area. That you must understand.
Okay. Yes.
Now, if that is understood, we need to also understand the way we are applying force also, the way this force per unit area is applied, that also plays a very, very important role in terms of whether a solid will break or not. For example, when an earthquake comes, okay, it just shakes the building a little bit and the building collapses. Okay. And similarly, if you apply a similar kind of force per unit area from top and bottom to the building, nothing happens to the building, right? And then you take a piece of let's say, paper, try to stretch it from both sides, the paper will not break. Okay. The moment you use a scissor, it immediately breaks with a small amount of force, or you can just tear it apart from the top. It loses its integrity. It goes off. Okay. Yeah. So that's why the way you apply force per unit area also matters. Okay. So now let us understand in how many ways can you apply this force per unit area. Okay. So suppose you have a piece of solid. Let's say I draw a cube over here. In how many ways can you deform the cube? Forget about breaking it. Breaking is the outcome. When you deform it too much, it will break.
Yeah. So
in what ways can you deform it?
By pushing it to, or keeping one end of it, the base stationary, and simply pushing one side of it.
Okay, so you could either increase its length, you can stretch it both sides.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
When I'm saying increasing its length, it could be width or height as well. All are same. Are you getting?
Yeah.
That is one way you can stretch it from both the sides. Another way is you can push it from here, keeping the base fixed. So this entire solid will get distorted. Okay, like this, it will get distorted. It will move, the side will move like this. Getting it?
Yeah, got it.
And another way is that you compress it from all sides, the volume will decrease. For example, you take a sponge and compress it from all sides, it will get compressed.
Yeah.
Okay, so these are the three typical ways in which you can deform a solid. Now, of course, it may not be that only one mode of deformation might be applied on a solid. There can be, let's say, two or three kinds of deformation happening together. Okay, but then when we are studying, we should study one by one in order to understand what is going on that kind of deformation. And once we know how multiple deformation cause and effect it is, then we can combine and analyze it together when they are happening. Okay. All right, so I'm going to introduce few concepts before we start discussing the various kinds of deformation. One is stress. Other is strain. Tell me, what is stress and what is strain? What is stress? Tell me.
It's basically the restoring force acting per unit area.
What do you mean?
For example, if you have a rubber band, something like that, and then you stretch it, then it'll try to oppose that deformation, and there'll be a force acting in the direction opposite to what you stressed, and that acting per unit of and that force is basically the restoring force, is basically the stress felt by the rubber band when you stretch it, and that acting per unit area of the rubber band is the stress.
What you are applying, what it is. Isn't that is the stress what you apply per unit area?
Yeah, I mean, I think, yeah, it should be correct. Isn't that also equal to the restoring force when...
But then why it is defined as restoring force? Is there a situation when both can be different? You always say.
Yeah, it can be. That is usually when it, when it can't, when the force you apply on it is too much, too high for there to be enough restoring force.
Okay. See, thus you can take a common sense thing that stress is with respect to how much stress you take. For example, if a simple thing is there, one person may think that it is very stressful. the other person will think that it is not so stressful. So it totally depends on how you react to a particular situation. Okay. Similarly, you know, you can apply, let's say, 1 lakh newton to just a rubber band. Okay. Mm-hmm. But rubber band itself is not capable to resist more than 100 newton. Okay. Then it will not react to 1 lakh newton itself. Okay. You understand what I'm trying to say?
Okay. Yeah.
It can't take 1 lakh newton. You are giving 1 lakh newton, but it is not taking it.
Okay.
So it can only resist up to 100 newton. Okay. So if you apply till 100 newton, then whatever you are applying will be equal to the stress. After that, it will remain 100 only, or it will break.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. So that is the difference. And that makes more sense when you compare the strength of two solids. Suppose you take steel and rubber. If it is about force applied, you can apply infinite force to the rubber, infinite force to the steel. So both have the same strength, is it? No. The strength has to do with how much resistance you are creating against what force is applied.
Okay.
Right? So steel will resist more. So
yeah.
Steel can take more resistance, more stress. All right. So stress is the amount of restoring force an object will have.
So it's the resistance against the force applied, right?
Yeah, resistance force per unit area.
Okay.
Got it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And most of the time it is whatever you're applying per unit area. So both are same only most of the time. Force per unit area. Now tell me one thing. You have a piece of solid. Like this, if you apply force F, okay, and this is area A. So stress is how much?
F by A.
It is free to move on a frictionless table.
Well, then there's no stress.
Oh, yeah.
Why no stress?
There's no resistance.
Is there a net force on it or not?
Yeah.
There is net force. So force per unit area is not the stress. That is the difference. Okay. If we calculate force per unit area as what force you are applying per unit area, then you'll be confused. Okay. It is about resistance. All right.
Yeah.
How to calculate the resistance? Resistance by whom? Resistance by the block only.
Yeah.
So what you do is that you cut this block. Imagine this block is cut. Okay. If you cut this block, then whatever is a force over here at this point is a resistance, and this is your force.
Yeah.
Okay.
Getting it? All right. But if I apply equal and opposite force, let's say if I apply F only over here, then what will be the acceleration?
No,
zero.
It will be zero. Net force is zero. Then if acceleration is zero, this F should be equal to that F only. Wherever you cut.
Yeah.
Are you getting it? So if it is the object is at rest, whatever you are applying will be equal to the resistance force only. Anywhere you cut along the block.
Yeah.
Okay. Because net force should be zero. It is at rest. Fine.
Yeah.
And this force, you can apply or you can just tie this end on a wall. Oh, sorry, you can let's say clamp this end on the wall so that it doesn't move. Then wall will apply the force. Different mechanism. Now, what is strain?
It's the change in length per unit length.
That is mathematical. What is conceptually, what is strain?
It's, okay, I don't know how to put it.
The amount is solid is deformed.
Oh. Hmm?
Is it the amount the solid is deformed?
No. It is basically, it is, you know, the strain has to do with basically how much deformation has happened. Understand what I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
Okay. So it's the amount of deformation, right?
you are giving stress to the solid. All right. Because of stress, what will happen? The solid will get deformed.
Yeah.
So stress is cause and strain is the effect.
Oh, why?
It is like when you say, I'm applying force. Acceleration is the effect of the force. Similarly, when you apply stress, strain is the effect of the stress.
Yeah.
Okay. It is the effect of the stress, and we are trying to quantify the deformation of the solid. Now, of course, that solid will get deformed in a different manner. So I cannot give a single formula for strain. It may be that length is getting deformed. It may be that volume is getting deformed, or it may be that the shape of the object is getting deformed. Fine. So different kind of deformation has different kind of definition. Okay.
Yeah.